Good morning, everybody, and thank you for being here today. I want to start by asking you a question. Can you imagine Pensacola as being the greatest place to live in the world? Easy, says Bill. Nice. Well, I hope you can, because we are going to make it happen. You and I, together, today. Because it's our mission at the Student Community Institute to improve the quality of life for people in Pensacola. And we have this huge, great big vision to make Pensacola the best place to live on Earth. And I love that, and I hope you do too. My name's Rachel Gillette. I have the pleasure of organizing these events for you. I'm the Director of Professional Development at Student Community Institute. And today we're going to have a great session on public speaking and presentation skills. And this is part of our training and development at Student Community Institute for business people like you. And it's by doing these training sessions that we're going to change Pensacola. We're going to make it a great place to live, improve the quality of life, and make it the best place to live in the world. So you are part of this journey with us. And I'm so grateful that you're here, because you are giving us one of the most valuable assets that you can give us, and that's your time this morning. And we appreciate that. There's some others that we appreciate this morning, and those are the people that have helped us as we put these on. Because it's really, really important to us that we do it at an affordable cost for you, so that you can be here and that you can bring your employees here. So as you came in, we had H2O Distributors. They're a local company, the only local provider of coffee and water. And they stepped up and they've helped us out, and they're providing us with the wonderful coffee and water that you have today. And Olive Baptist Church has partnered with us to give us these facilities for free, again, so that we can keep the costs down for you. In front of you, you have some information. One of them is a sheet with a big yellow bar down the side of it. It talks about how to be a member, a partner, community partner, or a supporting partner. And these are some of the organizations that have already joined us. Fair General Contractors and Combined Insurance Services. And we want you to join us at one of these levels as a partner too. So please take that away with you. Nicole Webb is here, and she'll be glad to talk to you about any of those levels and that information. You have an evaluation. It's really, really important to us to get feedback from you, because we want to provide you with the training and development that you want. We asked you some survey questions before you came, and it really helped Daniel prepare for today and make sure that we have the content that you need. So please, as you leave, fill out the evaluation, tell us how we did, tell us what else you want in terms of training and development, and we'll have people handing collecting those from you before you leave. And today we have a special treat for you if you do that. So we want you to tell people that you're here. Join us in the conversation on Twitter and on Facebook. So that there is two sides to that. We don't want you to be on your phone all day today and be just distracted. We want you to be in the room, be present, be learning. This is your time. As I said earlier, it's valuable, and we appreciate you being here. But we do want you to share out your experience and what you learned today. So please do that. The next event that we have coming up in our training and development series is on May 6th. Lynn Cunningham from Studer Group is going to be with us, and she's going to be dealing with this thing that a lot of people find very difficult. This is one of the things that you told us you wanted to hear: how to have those difficult conversations with difficult employees. And today, let's get on to the real meat of today. This was one of the highest rated requests that we had when we asked you about training, what you wanted. How to give a good presentation, how to speak in public. It was something that people struggle with. So we've brought Daniel, my good friend Daniel, in from who was at the Studer Group and now has his own company, Rockstar, at presentations and he is going to do a great job for us today, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about him. So Daniel began his career in Nashville at the largest film company in Tennessee. As a producer, he worked on national commercials with clients like GMC, KFC, Kraft Foods, Shoney's, and John Deere. From there, he was recruited to WVEC-TV, where as art director, he developed graphic packages for a number of regional BLO TV stations. Along the way, he also found time to write and illustrate two children's books. Returning to Nashville, Daniel was hired to create a new look and promotional branding for WSMV-TV, that's a mouthful, the flagship station in the Meredith Corporation. Alongside a team of top executives, Daniel ensured WSMV was the number one most watched TV station in the state every rating period for 8 years. For their efforts, the team were finalists for the Regional Emmy Awards. A beach lover, in 2002, Daniel jumped at the chance to work at WEAR-TV and suddenly found himself living on the sugar white sand beaches of Pensacola. Daniel directed a team of video professionals to create cutting-edge television programs, commercials, and news products to enhance the Sinclair brand. His team racked up an impressive list of Addy Awards along the way, as well as helping more than 10,000 new business teams to present their products and services through the medium of television. In 2010, Daniel joined the Studer Group as a video specialist, where he worked extensively with Studer Group's top speakers and presenters. Along the way, he began training new speakers and subject matter experts on how to present their content. Now, as an independent consultant, Daniel works with local firms to enhance their executives' presentation skills. In one-on-one training and small group exercises, Daniel's able to help almost any presenter improve their skills and become bulletproof. Let's welcome Daniel.
Thank you. I just happen to like this slide. This slide says 85% of your success has to do with your ability to communicate and lead. 85%. Now I know some of us have PhDs and some of us have EDDs and some of us have MBAs. But look at how startling that is. 85% of your success has to do with your ability to present well. And so, as sobering as that is, I mean, you think, well, gosh, I did all this work, and now, look, you know, 85% is about how, I'm not very good at presenting. The nice thing about this is you really can learn this skill relatively quickly. Generally speaking, we do this in small group exercises. We have 8 or 10 people in a room, and we go for 4 consecutive weeks. Like every Monday, we'll meet for a couple of hours. And it's amazing that we can take somebody who is absolutely terrible on day one, and they'll be absolutely fantastic on the fourth week. So this is something that you can learn, and you can learn over time. So I'm excited that you're here, because obviously you guys understand that this is something that will help your career. And it really does. I mean, if you think about it, in 2004 at the Democratic National Convention, a self-described skinny kid with a funny name stood up and gave a presentation. And Barack Hussein Obama went from being nobody to being the leader of the free world. I mean, the next day, every news channel wanted him. Everyone wanted to do it. Who is this kid? Do you think that your presentation that you do could launch you into something like that? Do you think that when you fail to do a good presentation, that somebody in your company may say, I don't know about this person. I know somebody right now. She's talented and she's gifted and she's got great critical thinking skills. She's at an entry-level position. She's been there for 12 years. She cannot move up. You know why? Because in a meeting, when she talks, she sounds like a valley girl. I have a question. And nobody has confidence that she would do a good job. And so there she is. She's stuck. Have you ever been stuck? Right. I mean, that's a terrible feeling. She's stuck. She cannot move up from there. But these are really things that you can learn. Every story starts somewhere, right? Photograph here has two people. It's a high school yearbook photograph. In the front is Karen Waldron. We know because it says up top. And behind her, that devastatingly handsome man, is Dan Pennington. And at the top it says the quietest. And when the rest of you guys were being voted most likely to succeed, or most athletic, or you were being voted most studious, I was being voted quietest. Now every now and then I have somebody in my class and they say, but you don't get it, Daniel. You don't understand. I'm shy. Look, sister, I won an award for it. And I kid, and it's funny, and I bring this up because it is a little self-deprecating humor, but the reality is that man wasn't getting anything he wanted out of life. Nothing. He wasn't getting the girls, because in order to get the girl, you have to talk to the girl, right? And if you never talk to the girl, you never get the girl. You wasn't getting the grade, because what? You have to raise your hand in class. Miss Wilkinson, I know the answer to that question. He wasn't getting the job, because you have to go in and ask. Mr. Fernandez, I understand you're hiring. So if he hadn't changed, now this was 1978, you guys do the math, just turned 55. Everybody's going, okay, carry the one. If he hadn't changed at 55, I wouldn't have had a very good life. Well, I've had a great life because he figured out how to go beyond that. It's all about this word, engagement. I know we have a lot of educators in the room. We have at least four educators in the room, and thank you for being here. But if we ever had a speech class, chances are good we had a speech class in school. And I have to say, I think that school is the absolute worst place in the world to learn how to speak. You know why? Because of that word. Because of engagement. If you're in high school, whose responsibility is it for you to be engaged? It's yours, right? Because if you don't listen, you don't take notes. If you don't take notes, then you don't pass the test. If you don't pass the test, you may not pass the grade, and then you get held back. And so you have an incentive. You're incentivized to learn. You're incentivized to pay attention. You're incentivized to be engaged. But in an adult world, here today, whose responsibility is engagement? It's mine. It's only mine, right? And so you have to do a lot more. Now, we have teachers who are engaging. I don't mean to disparage anybody. We have teachers that work their butts off to be engaged. But what I'm saying is, it's a different thing. In high school, you're hostages. You have to be there. In real life, you can get up and get your purse and walk out the door, or sit back there and on your phone and play Angry Birds the whole time. Nothing I can do about it. I have to work harder to be engaged, to have you be engaged. And I really grew up in TV. I spent a great deal of time, 35 years total, in television. And in television, you know how easy it is for you to vote me off the island? Malia knows. You got 245 channels. Don't like you. Funny hair. Boring. Not interested. Seen it. We understand that. In Nashville, when I worked at that TV station, if we went from a 5.4 to a 5.5 in ratings in our 6 o'clock news, the TV station made $1 million extra dollars. That's an incentive to get you and to keep you engaged. And we go through crazy amounts of exercises to get you and keep you engaged. Because we understand, the moment you click it off, we lose the money. And then here I worked with a lot of small businesses. Small business owners would come into WEAR and they'd want to get a commercial or a segment in the news or a segment in the program. And if I was really good at my job, their business would grow. And if I was really bad at my job, you know, sometimes they would devote $10,000 or $20,000, $30,000 to a commercial that they had. If it stunk, they could go out of business. So I have a different discipline than maybe the last time you had a public speaking course. My discipline is all about this word, engagement. And we have to keep people engaged. And everything we talk about today is about that. How do we get people engaged, and how do we keep them engaged the entire time? Okay? So my big promise for you is this. Over the next 45 minutes or so, I'm going to give you everything I can to teach you how to get and keep your audience engaged. We're going to talk about storytelling. We're going to talk about how to use your stage. We're going to talk about body language. We've got a lot we're going to go through. My goal is for you to go home with two or three or four or five things that you can put into practice right away. I'm not into theory. I'm not into thinking up here. I want something that you can do today, even if you're not on stage. I want something that you will make you a better communicator no matter what you do. That's my goal. So at the end of the day, I want you to walk out of here with something. I would love to have you guys catch me in the Publix grocery store and say, Daniel, you know what? That thing you taught us, the next day I had to talk and I used that and it worked. That's thrilling to me. Now, not only am I giving a presentation, I'm teaching you about presentation, but I'm also giving a presentation. It's kind of weird, isn't it? It's the inception kind of thing. But I want to point out some of the things that we've already gone through that are pointers. One, I was introduced. Thank you, Rachel. I was introduced, and she did a great job of my introduction. You know why she did a great job of my introduction? Because I wrote it. Exactly. You need, the nice thing about having somebody introduce you is that they can set you up for success. She can say things about me that I could not comfortably say about myself. Ask to be introduced. I was at a work function a few years ago, and I was going to speak to the people at work, and they said, will you speak? And I said, sure, will you introduce me? And they said, that's crazy. These people know you. You've worked here 3 years. And I said, no, I want to be introduced. And she said, okay, we'll introduce you. But what you guys just heard about my history, those people had never heard, you know? And so it's a chance to set you up for success. Be introduced every time. Write your own introduction. And then send it to them ahead of time, your event coordinator ahead of time, and then bring a copy with you because they will have lost it. Rachel did not, but most people will have lost it. So that's number one. Number two, the first slide we had up there, the Carnegie slide, that's all about you. This presentation is not about me at all. It's all about you. Your success in the next few years is dependent on your ability for you to be good at presenting. You. You know what everybody's favorite word is? Dale Carnegie said everybody's favorite word is their own name. And I believe that. And if I meet you, I'll make a big deal about your name because that helps me to remember, but it's also a really sweet word to hear your own name. Now, we're in a big group. We got, what did we end up with, 54 people? So I can't call everybody by their name. But a number of years ago, Stanford University did a study, and they said in marketing and advertising, what's the top words to use in marketing advertising? Number one word is you. This is a way you can get. This is what you can do. This is what you'll get out of this. So that slide is a you-focused. That is a you-focused message. That sets you up and says, not only am I concerned about you, but we actually talked about the problem or the challenge or the opportunity that you will face. Now, I get a lot of people who say, you know, I'm shy. I struggle to be up in front of a crowd. Well, the more that you think about your audience and the less you think about yourself, the more confident you will be. So if you can get out of your head and you can get out here, then you'll be confident. I am laser focused on one thing, which is helping you guys give a better presentation. I am laser focused. So if I trip, if I fall, if I make a mistake, I don't care. I'm worried about you. Get out of your own head and get out here where the audience is and focus on them. The audience wants you to succeed. I mean, you guys want me to succeed. If I make a mistake, you're not going to care, will you? Nobody cares. If I mess up, if I leave something out of my notes and I don't cover it, you won't know. But even if I do, if I tripped, if I fell, if I made a big mistake, nobody cares. Get out of your own head. Get out here and be focused on you getting everything that you want out of this. Now, it's important to notice that you is singular. It's not plural. So as we talk, you and I are communicating. And you and I are talking. It's singular. And then as soon as I say the collective, how many of y'all have been to Baltimore? Then you look around, you're, oh, well, he wasn't talking to me, he's talking to everybody. But for the moment, we lock on, and you and I are talking. So, singular you. make it you focused. The other thing about the Carnegie slide, that first slide, is that's my why. You know, my why do I do what I do? Why was I here at 6 o'clock in the morning? Why am I doing this? Why did I practice this like 600 times? Because that's my why. I realize that there are people who will not take that next step, who will not move up, who will not get what they want out of life until they learn how to do this. And I'm focused on that. That's my why. You have great conversations with people when you ask them what their why is. I spend a lot of time interviewing people. I probably interviewed 40 people this month. That's a lot. And it's a good conversation when we talk about the how and the what. We have a good conversation. But when I ask them what their why is, then we have a great conversation. You know what? That's the other thing about not being shy. When you're passionate about your subject, when you really care, people get that passion, and then it takes it to a different level, right? Then you're starting to have a different kind of conversation. I interviewed somebody who's a life flight nurse, Melissa. Melissa's a life flight nurse, and when I started the interview, she was all about her how and the what, how and the what. How many times, how many this, how many that, and then the what, how many of this, how many of that. And then I said, well, what about your why? You ever saved lives? Yeah, of course. Well, let's talk about those. And then she began telling me stories about, the number of times that she would pick up a kid. They would fly out somewhere and pick up some kid that's been hurt in an accident and fly back, and she would hold their hands and she would sing songs to them. So when you talk about, and the other reason, I know, the other reason why I showed you the quietest photo is it humanizes me. It makes me, you know, you're connected to me. And you're looking at that and going, well, gosh, he's kind of a goof, you know? It's really easy for people to say, well, that's fine for you, but I couldn't do it. But when you show a photo as bad as that, you're like, oh, okay, well, I'm not as bad off as that guy is. And then I did the big promise at the end. So at the end of that section, I said, this is what you're going to get out of today. Okay? So that's the big promise. So one of the tips I want you to do every time is to stand up. Stand up every time. If you're in a room with 38 people and you're 15th to speak, nobody else has stood up, still stand up. You know? Always stand up. Any chance you get, stand up. Because here's what happens. You'll be in a work group, there's 30 people in the room, and then they look and they say, Pennington, why don't you talk about the McKinsey account? And he'll be over here going, okay, well, the McKinsey account is a couple of weeks overdue. Everybody in the room is like, well, who's talking? Where is that? Who is that? Now imagine instead you say, let's talk about the McKinsey account, and I stride to the middle of the room where everybody can see me, and I say, okay, three things you need to know about McKinsey. This is leadership. Sitting at your desk is not. Stand up every chance you get. Number two, what do I do with my hands? Everybody's favorite question, what do I do with my hands? There's only one answer. And this is nice because this is really simple, but I want you to do it every time. Your hands go right here, right in front of your face, right in front of your belt. So keep your hands right here. Just keep them right here. Because this is what happens. People will look at your face and they'll look at your hands. They'll look at your face and they'll look at your hands. This is your communication zone. This is where everybody's going to focus. And so you keep your hands here and then you make these smaller gestures. Most people, they'll put them in their pockets. That's terrible. You know, in Japanese culture, they won't even negotiate with you if they can't see your hands. What are you hiding? Or if you put them behind your back, same thing. It's terrible. Keep your hands right here. This is the right place to keep your hands. And then you can gesture. Of course, I have notes. You can gesture. Sometimes you have a piece of paper or you have the glasses, reading glasses, but they go right here. Somebody asked in the pre-work, how do I keep from being monotone? Three answers. You vary your speed, you vary your volume, and you vary your sentence length. You vary your speed, you vary your volume, and you vary your sentence length. It's not that hard. If we went down to the Pensacola Little Theater and we grabbed somebody's book out of their hands and we said, what are you working on? And you looked at it and you looked in the margin, you can see all this little annotation, all the way up and down it. All that annotation is, here's where I pause. Here's where I stop. Here's where I say it fast. Here's where I say it loud. Here's where, right? And by doing that, nobody ever gets bored because you say one sentence really loud. My gosh, there's a lot of people here today. And then the next one, you're going to get intimate and you say, you know what? I am so glad that you guys showed up today. You say one sentence really fast, followed by one that's really slow. When you write out your speech, write out short sentences and long sentences. And between all of that, you will find that you're able to keep people's attention. Now, if there's one thing I want you to walk out of here today, is this one. This is the big punch. The difference between, now I worked with some of the best speakers in the world at Student Group. And then I worked with some of the subject matter experts that are smart people, but they're terrible at presenting. And you know what? The biggest difference between a professional speaker who gets $15,000 to come out and speak and the amateur, their ability to pause. There is nothing you can do that will have greater impact on your presentation than to pause. Watch that speech I was just talking to you about with Barack Obama. Pauses are 6 seconds long. Do you know what that feels like when you're up here and you wait for 6 seconds? So there's not a liberal America. And there's not a conservative America. It's a long time. But what seems to happen is you listen to me when I'm talking, but you really understand me when I pause. Learn to pause. Pause makes emphasis. If you have a point, you don't want to walk while you're making your point, but pause either before or after it. It puts emphasis on something. So if I come over here and I say, you know what we figured out? After years of work, we figured out if you don't measure it, you can't move it. And those pauses tell you, oh, he's probably saying something important. The other thing I didn't point out, but when I came up here after Rachel's introduction, I didn't fill it up with a lot of nonsense chatter. The general tendency, see if you see this. Next time you see somebody speak, if they don't come up to you and say, well, thank you, Rachel, it's a very good introduction, appreciate that, and then they fill it up with the whole genesis of how this thing happened and who started and what happened after that and all like that. In 3 minutes, you guys are bored off your tails. You can't stand it, right? But that's what you want to do. That's the natural tendency, is to give you 3 minutes of, well, I was talking to Quinn 3 months ago, and then he said maybe this, and he said, you guys don't care. Start with the you. Start with the problem. Start with the solution. Start with the great stuff. You know, used to watch Star Trek. Star Trek travels through all these universes and all of these planets and all of these universes, and then they beam down to a planet. Where do they beam down? Like 12 feet away from where the action is. Really? I mean, I would have to, like, take a burrow and a, you know, it'd be like 3 miles. Wait. I'm going to get there. Wait. But they beam down where the action is. That's where I want you to be. Beam down where the action is. I had a news director in Nashville, Al Tompkins, and he was a big guy, and he was a blustery, loud, aggressive guy, and he had a new reporter, a new photographer came in when I was in his office, and they covered a fire that people died in. They put it in the tape, and they said, Al, we want to see what you think of this. And he popped it right back out. He said, if you cover a fire, the first frame of the first thing needs to have flames in it. Don't cover a fire, folks, and don't put flames in your front. Watch TED Talks. Their opening line is often shocking. When my brother died, it was the first time I felt like I could live. Lean forward. That's a lean forward statement. If your opening statement isn't pretty darn good, there's no way you can keep people. I grew up in TV. I understand. I've got 30 seconds tops, or else you check out. Enthusiasm. I have a little Jack Russell. Should have brought a picture of him. You'd love to see Champ. Champ, the little Jack Russell. Champ is pure enthusiasm. That's all he does. He's just, I mean, if he had a keyboard, the exclamation point would just be worn off. He would type in all capital letters. You want to go to the park? Oh, God, yeah. You want to go to the mailbox? Yeah. You want to sit out here? Yeah. Everything's like enthusiasm. Look, whatever your subject is, if you're talking to me about it, if you're not enthusiastic about it, there is no way I'm going to be enthusiastic about it. How do we know this is exciting? Because we can hear it in your voice. How do we know you're bored out of your gourd? Because we can hear it in your voice. Now, I know you've been doing this for 28 years, and I realize that at some point, it just becomes rote and you're just saying the same thing over and over again. Well, during your closing, you're going to find that the title insurance does the whatever. But if you don't have enthusiasm, I can't be enthusiastic. Listen to Ira Flatow, Science Fridays on UWF. These scientists, I don't know if they coach them or whatever, but the scientists are always so excited about everything. I mean, it's the neatest thing. I listen to it, I don't even know what they're talking about. But they will say, oh, these nanoparticles are doing stuff that we never expected anything to do. I mean, this I'm gonna get so excited about it. You have to be excited about it. Let's talk about microphones. There's going to be one of four things for your microphone situation. I don't have a microphone today, so that's number one. This is a mic. You see I've mic'd up there. This is a mic, but I'm connected to his camera. We don't have anything broadcasting in here. With 54 people, we felt like, yeah, I could probably be loud enough you guys can hear me. Everybody's hearing me all right, right? You guys in the back, you're not? But you have one of four situations for it. So you're going to either have no microphone in a relatively small group, or you're going to have this kind of a microphone. This is a lavalier mic, and it has a little battery pack here on the back, right? See that? So this comes up more often with females than with males. You have to have a place to put that battery pack. So if you have certain dresses, my wife said this to me the other day, sheath dress. Is that a word? But if you have certain dresses, you cannot put that microphone anywhere. And then you're stuck. What are you going to do? You'd have to carry it around. It's weird. The other thing is you can get so this is a great mic because I can be totally hands-free, you know? Even though you're not actually hearing me on the microphone. And then you'll have a handheld mic. Now, handheld mics really work pretty well. I like them. But the problem is if you speak for an hour and a half, you can really lock up your shoulder, you know? Now, here's another point I want you to write down. When you speak, you're in charge. So Rachel and I are friends, and we worked through this venue together. We talked about it ahead of time. We talked about how the room was set up. We talked about where your chairs are. We talked about how long I was going to have to talk. We talked about the slide deck. We have had all those conversations. You're in charge. So if I got in here and there was a big pole here in the center of this thing, I need to talk to Rachel about it and see if we don't have another solution, right? So you're in charge. But anyway, so you have this microphone. But your arm can lock up if you talk for an hour and a half. So you got to be careful with that. But they're pretty good. If it's 15 minutes, it's great. You know? And then the other microphone, oh my gosh, is a podium. Bane of my existence, people. Here's what you do on a podium. You come up here and you got your little microphone on your podium. And what everybody does is they bring their notes, and all of their notes are laid out right here. And they grab this side and they grab this side and they clench like this, the death grip. And then they bury their head in their notes. And you spend an hour and a half looking at that bald spot right there. If somebody gives you a podium, reject it. Tell them I'll stand in the middle of the room and scream before I work off a podium. That is the worst thing ever. Because almost everything we're talking about here about engagement involves you moving around. So one of the tools that you will use is a story. Now there's three good ways to have people remember your content. You know, most of the time, if I came up here and did bullet points, you know, 75 bullet points, 100 bullet points, you're going to go home, you're going to remember two or three things. But if I tell you a story, you'll remember it forever. If I tell you a good story, it'll be with you for the rest of your life. One of the ways you can get people to remember your stuff is using an acronym. Like Zig Ziglar says, fear is false evidence appearing real. Use an acronym. Now, here's how powerful that is. I haven't listened to that Zig Ziglar tape in 25 years. And it's the first one I thought of. Can you imagine if something we talked about today, in 2041, you went, yeah, I remember that Daniel Pennington talking about that. False evidence appearing. Use an acronym. It's a really good way to get people to remember it. The other one is an action. So a really great speaker is a guy named Craig Valentine, and he talks about having a barrel of crabs. He's from Maryland. And if you take a barrel of live crabs and you pop the top off, what happens? They try to get out. But he said they don't actually get out. Because what happens is every time one of them starts to crawl up over the edge, the ones behind him reach up and grab him and pull him down. And so he said, isn't that like negative people? Y'all ever known somebody that was negative? You know? And every time you try to do something, you're like, oh, that isn't going to work. And you got this action. And so then every time Craig, throughout the rest of his speech, he talks about anybody that's negative. He said, I was going to write a book. And I told the wrong person, I'm planning on writing a book. And then you know what he said? That's probably not a great idea. See, that action now is sunk in. So after a while, you don't even have to say it. You just go, oh, I met this guy, and man, you got that negativity. And then the third way is an anecdote or a story. Jesus said, somebody asked him, why do you teach in parables? And he said, I talk and they don't listen. I teach and they don't understand. Since the beginning of time, we've understood things in terms of stories. I saw Quint at Studer Education in Chicago. Studer Education is the same thing as Studer Group, but Studer Group focuses on healthcare, and Studer Education does the exact same thing, but they do it for schools. It's great if you get a chance. They're just doing great work there. So they were able to borrow Quint for the day, and he had 45 minutes, and he told 5 stories. Now, in each one of those stories was a message. There was a reason he told it. But he told 5 stories. At the end of the day, at the end of his 45 minutes, they gave him an 8-minute standing ovation. The ovation almost lasted longer than his speech. Now, that's the power of story. You'll walk home with the story, and in there will be your message. So you're not telling stories just to tell stories. We're not storytellers. But what is it you want people to understand? You know, you take that and you put it inside a story. Like one of the things that I talk about is if you don't measure it, you can't move it. If you don't measure it, you can't move it. And so I tell the story about moving from Pensacola Beach into East Hill. And when you sell a beach house, you sell it often fully furnished. And so I moved into East Hill and I had nothing. But that was a great experience for me because I got to go through the Bed Bath and Beyond, say I want one of those, and I want one of those, and I want one of those. But when it came time to a bathroom scale, I thought, I've never owned a bathroom scale. You saw my picture? I was a skinny kid. I weighed 123 pounds when I was in college. I was a skinny kid. What do you need a bathroom scale for? Skinny? Still skinny. So I'm going through Bed Bath & Beyond. I go, oh, bathroom scale. I'm in my 40s now, so I might need one of these. And I put it on the ground, and I step up on it. And that number was not the number that I expected. It wasn't 123 pounds anymore. And you ever blame the item for giving you bad news? I'm like, well, apparently that thing is broken. And I grab it and I put it up on the shelf and I take another one and put it down. And I step up on that. Surprisingly enough, this was broken in exactly the same way. By the time I got to the third one, I realized the problem isn't in the measurement. The problem's in me. So I've told you a story, but the message is you have to measure it. And so later on in my presentation, I can say, look, guys, if you don't measure it, you can't move it. And this is now the bathroom scale. Right? So that's a way to tell story. And that's a way to tell the story and make your point. So you're going to have a point, but you're going to tell it in terms of a story. So if you want your people to get involved in the story, you want to invite them in. Invite people in. And you do that by asking something that is universal. So if I were telling a story about running a marathon, I have not run a marathon. Don't ask me about it later. I've not run a marathon. But if I was telling a story about running a marathon, you got to realize that everybody in your audience has not run a marathon. In fact, some of them get out of bed and have to sit down for a while because they get out of breath. Right? That's kind of me at the moment. But you want to say, what is the universal? What is the universal? And so you might say, have you ever failed? Have you ever failed in a really big way? Have you ever failed publicly in front of your friends and your relatives? In marathon, it's called DNF, did not finish. And then you go on and tell the story about how you failed in the marathon. And now they're like, oh, okay, I relate to you. I got it. I'm understanding what you're talking about. One of the stories I talk about is, well, you ever been so mad that you can't make words? You ever been, really mad? Like, sometimes when you're just mad, you're just mad and you can get out and cuss and scream and stuff. But sometimes you're so mad that you just can't even make real words. You ever been that mad? I'm telling you, 2012, March 16th, my birthday in Nashville, Tennessee, you and I are sitting in this beautiful, brand new Miata. Midnight blue, supple leather seats. Feel that leather? Listening to the radio, the top is down, that Nashville air is blowing through the cab of the thing. Oh my goodness, is this good. We got radio playing, Al Jarreau's playing. Just the two of us. We can make it if we try. So all of this. And then we hear, you and I hear a different noise. Beep, beep, beep. The sound of a truck backing up. Now we're in a line of traffic. There's a line of traffic that way. There's a line of traffic that way. We're waiting. We're cool with waiting because we're in the coolest car. We're cool with waiting, but we're waiting. Truck right here to the right is backing up right into us, right toward us. Now here's the problem with the delivery truck and the Miata. Delivery truck's mirror, here. Miata, here. He looks in his rearview mirror and he says, hey, I got a clear lane. Next thing we hear is the sound of that car being pushed by that bumper all the way out of that lane and into the oncoming lane. I'd had my car for 6 hours. And I got out and he got out and I couldn't even form words. Now I tell you that story because what we've used in just under 2 minutes is you're totally with me in that story. We have used cues called, write this down, V-A-K-S. V-A-K-S, which is a visual. Did you see the car? Did you see your mind's eye? Did you see that midnight blue with the supple leather Italian? Did you? And then we have audio. What were we listening to? Al Jarreau. Just the two. I'll sing it again if you want. I like that. And then you have audio and then you have kinesthetic, what something feels like. So you feel the breeze, you feel the leather, and then this S is smell. We smell that fresh, clean air. But in 2 minutes, I've taken you, now we've invited you in. Have you ever been so mad? Invited you in, now you're part of the story. The other thing to write down is you tell the story present tense. See, because nobody's interested in what happened to you, tell it right like you're with me. Okay, so you are in the seat with me when all this happens. So that's a great way to tell a story. Now, somewhere in there, I would attach this to a message. I wouldn't be telling the story just to entertain you. But by using the V-A-K-S, you made it real, right? And by using the universal and then inviting people in. All right, now, really quickly, we're going to talk about using your stage. There's two ways that people use stage, and both are incorrect. You either get this person here who comes out and he gets on this edge of the stage. Now, we don't actually have a stage. You notice that, right? Because you guys are smart. He comes out here and he talks to this group of people the whole time, just right there. You guys get a pretty good show. Those people look in my ear. That guy over there is looking in my, right? Or, so that's one. I don't know why people do this. You have the luxury of all of this space and you don't use it, you know? Use this space. Make it work for you. You have all this space. So why do you come over here and lock in and don't move? I guess you're just nervous. Then the other way that people don't use their space well is they do like the Bengal tiger. You know, like this. San Diego Zoo. And they move the whole time. And you get a neck ache just watching them. You need to move with purpose. Okay? So you have a real advantage here. You can do different things. So I can come down here. And I can be kind of intimate. Like we could have We could have a discussion down here, right? Now, I'm still doing it in a stage whisper, so hopefully everybody's hearing that. Mary, are you hearing me? Okay. But then I can come back here, and I can be bigger and broader and be louder. So, you know, let's say we're down here, and I'm talking about concussions, big subject in the news right now. And I'm saying, you know what? My son had 2 concussions in high school. And then the next thing that I noticed, he was having trouble remembering things. And I thought, am I a bad parent? And then I could sit, okay, so that was one discussion. I'm going to take a chapter heading, and I'm going to step back, and then back here, still in the same subject, but a different aspect of it, and say, when we're trying to get some laws passed that would change the way football is regulated in high schools. So you see that? I'm like down here, and it's intimate, and then I step back here, and then I'm bigger. Now we're talking about something that's less emotional, right? So you can use those spaces that way. So you use it as chapter headings. If you have 3 or 4 or 5 different chapters, you know, you're talking about different things in one speech, you can take that pause and step away. Okay? Now what we're going to do is we're going to do an assignment. You guys at your table are going to give a 5-minute presentation to each other at your table. And I want you to utilize some of the things that we have talked about. Now, I understand you can't, you know, learn to ride a bike by reading a book. You can't roller skate, you know, by watching a video. You won't necessarily get this in the next couple of minutes. But 5 minutes, a 5-minute presentation, but it has to include a story. Use your VAKS. It has to include something about your why. And you can make it up, but make it important. What's important to you? You know? And then 5 minutes, and then about 30 minutes from now, we're going to stop. I'll take a couple of questions, and then I'm going to close out the day. Does that make sense? Do you have any questions at this point? All right.
I have a question.
All right, I got one more activity for us. Would everybody please stand? Okay. All right, let's stand like Superman. How does Superman stand? All right, let me tell you, this is a great TED Talk. You get a chance to watch this. A lady named Amy Cuddy, who is a researcher at Harvard Psychology, she noticed that when her men students came in the room, they took up a lot of space. They would like put this over there, they do the man spreading, you know, got the whole thing going here. And then she noticed that her women students would come in and take up a little bit of space. And she asked the question, she said, do the men act that way because they're raging with testosterone, or do they do this movement, this gesture, and then their testosterone levels go up? It's a good question, chicken or egg. So what they're able to test this really, really easily. We could go to you and we can get a little inside swab on the inside of your mouth, and there's 2 hormones at work. Testosterone, which makes you confident, cortisol, which is your stress hormone. And they got to see where you were. So test before, and then she'd have people stand. Power poses, we're gonna do it now. Power poses, this is our power pose. Superman, Wonder Woman, right? And then what's the other one? When you win a race, what do? Yeah, yeah, win that race, yeah. And then the third one is a hole-in-one golf shot. What do? Pump your arm.
No idea.
Yeah. Whenever Bill does one, he's gonna go, yeah. So let's do this, come on people. Yeah, yeah. So here's what happened, is at the end of 2 minutes of power poses, they test them again. And you know what? Biologically, you are incredibly more confident after 2 minutes of power posing. Do you know what I was doing at 8:25? I was in the back power posing. Whenever you get a chance to do this, do this. Biologically, you've changed yourself forever, for the next little while. So right at your table, let's go. 5-minute presentation. Something new? Do you have something that you incorporated into your presentation that you didn't have before? Right? Something new? You're going to walk out of here with something? You're going to say, gosh, this was great. I learned something new. Write it on your evaluation, but don't give me a positive evaluation just to do it. I mean, I love you, but be truthful. If there's something I missed, if there's something you would have liked to have seen that I didn't cover, let me know, because I'll do this again. Let me know. Honest feedback. I love honest feedback. Does anybody have any questions?
I have one.
Yeah.
So why did you have
Stand up. Always. I love Cheryl. Cheryl and I are friends, so always stand up. You know, I noticed at your table that you weren't standing up. I just said that. I feel like I'm with my kids. I just told you. What'd you say? I'm sorry, Cheryl. Why did I only have one slide? That's a very good question. You know how I know that's a good question? Because I asked Cheryl to ask it. I did. You want to take all of the air out of your balloon? Get to the end of a really great day. Boy, we had a good time today. Get to the end of a really great day and say, y'all have any questions? Crickets. Oh my goodness. So plant a question. Plant a question. And Cheryl was good enough to ask it. But get somebody, you don't have to do a Q&A, depending on what you're talking about. You don't have to do a Q&A. And a lot of times they get far afield. The person asking the question apparently watched some other presentation, because they'll ask you something about, I don't know, dogs in the Rockies, and you're like, what? How did that play in? You don't have to do a Q&A, but if you do, stay in charge of it. Make sure that it's the Q&A you want to answer. What else? What else did we learn? Anybody else, Mary, Dr. Mehta?
Danny, what do you do when you're going to speak to a group that has a very regimented forum for their meeting? Like, it has a podium, but then it's got tables on each side with people sitting there eating, and you're used to walking around, and mm-hmm. the microphone's attached to the podium.
Right. That's a good question. And I didn't answer Cheryl's question either, so I'll get back to you, dear. That's a good question. I think you just have to be bossy. Now, I came in here yesterday, Rachel and I came in here yesterday, and if this wasn't exactly the way I wanted it, we would have moved stuff around. I think you just have to be bossy. Nobody else stands up. You have a microphone on a podium. Just ask them. Your AV person, we don't have an AV person here today, but your AV person should be your best friend. So when Rachel asked me to speak, the second thing I should say is, tell me about the AV setup, and then is there a person? So if we were going to do this at WSRE, somebody would have mic'd me up, we would have a stage and all like that, and I would say, tell me who that is, let me get in touch with them, and say, very few places don't have some kind of microphone situation. And if you beg, and if you're in charge of the organization, as Dr. Mehta is, if you're in charge, you can get that kind of cooperation. But I'm very bossy when it comes to this. I mean, I want to be successful. I want you to get this, and so I will move anything. We could have changed buildings if I didn't like this room, because I would have insisted, right? So that's a good question. I'll get to you in just a second. Cheryl, your question, I hate PowerPoint. I really do. PowerPoint should not be in control. Do not allow the technology to dictate to you what you do. I have a good friend, Bob Murphy. He's a fantastic student group speaker. He is great. And we saw him in Jeffersonville, Indiana, and he's telling this great story. He said everybody in the airport, I forget which airport it was, Chicago, was dressed in gray and black and gray and black and gray and black, and like a sea of gray and black. And one woman on the escalator is dressed like Jessica Rabbit. You know, bright red dress, bright red hair, red lipstick, red shoes. She goes up the escalator, and when she gets to the top, her heel is stuck, and she stopped. Amazingly enough, the men are there to help her. You wouldn't have predicted that, right? And before long, it's a couple of men, and before after that, there's like 10 men, and then 15 men, and all of these people are trying to extricate her from that. So Bob is telling this great story. We're laughing. We're having a great time. And he looks at his slide deck, and he goes, oh, the third R of leadership is... And he goes back to his presentation. Do not allow the technology to control you. The nice thing about having no slides or almost no slides is you dictate. And if you're getting it, if we're in sync, then I can go wherever I want. But if this has the third R of leadership on it, I feel compelled to talk about that. Get rid of as many slides as you can. Don't do bullet points. Bullet points kill me. Oh my gosh, seas and seas of bullet points. What was your question, sir?
It's really about presentations that involve a lot of data. Is there a way
yes.
to avoid them, to make presentations that have a lot of data?
So his question, if you didn't hear it, is what do you do when the presentation has to have a lot of data in it? Yes, you have to do those presentations. And most people have some data in every presentation. Even if you're a graphic designer, you have some data in that. But the way to do that, you do have to have slides. Make them as simple as possible. You know, if you say, I know you can't read this, that's a sign you shouldn't have put that up there, right? So if you have to put data up there, make it as simple as possible. If you have four bullet points, put those on four separate pages. Make your font. Here's the rule of thumb. Take the oldest person in the room, which is me, divide his age by half, and that should be your minimum font size. So have somebody that's 60 years old, and you use a font that's less than 30 points, you've made a mistake. All of our eyes go really bad as we get older. So, but if you have data, do a little data and then find a way to make it real to me. We had somebody in our class not too long ago who had a fantastic speaker. Could not complain. He had great data. He was talking about childhood poverty, and he had great data, and he had statistics, and he was so good at everything. But I said to him, hey, you know, you've got to tell stories. You've got to make this real to me. The longest journey is from your head to your heart. And I understood what he was talking about with childhood poverty, but I didn't feel it. We go 4 weeks in these classes, right? And every week I said, you got to tell me a story that matters. You're talking about childhood poverty. There's got to be a good story in there, right? And so we go every week. And then we get down to the last class. Before the last class, I sit in his office and I said, I don't care what. You got to tell me a story. And he stood up and he said, Daniel, I can not. And I thought, I failed. I don't often fail. These really do go very well. But I failed. And the next day in our class, he wanted to be the first one to speak. And he got up. He still told the same data. He still had data in there. He still had slides and he still had bar graphs. But he talked about childhood poverty in a way that was so real to us. These little kids that go to school and they can't even learn because their stomachs are hurting so bad. And these little kids lined up for the nurse's station because they overeat at lunch. And they can't. They have tummy aches the rest of the day. And I'm telling you, when you know you do a good presentation when the end, nobody said anything. We all just sat in our chairs. And we were totally silent for like 2 minutes because it was so good. Because all of a sudden, we felt it. So you need to find a way to take it outside the data and tell a story about that. Story, connect that data into a story. Now, we can talk offline and go into that in a little more detail. Other questions? And then I'm going to wrap up. We've got 3 minutes here. Yes, sir. Look, he stood up. Yay! My work here is done.
Kind of back on to what you were just saying.
Yes.
In the midst of the presentation, you can feel the audience. You know, and that you probably can you involve? I know you start, you know, you kind of get out of where you are, or you just stick with what you have.
It's a good question. So do you wing it or do you stick with your presentation as it is? I've worked on this presentation like a million times, so I know it backwards and forwards. I could do it completely backwards. As a matter of fact, my wife and I just traveled to South Florida and back 9.5 hours down there, 9.5 hours back. I did this probably 12 times during that trip. She could probably do it as well as I do because she's heard it so many times. It depends on who you are, Raymond. Are you good at winging it? I mean, some people, Quint, can wing it. I can kind of wing it. But the more times you do the same presentation, this should go for everybody. You're going to talk about your company, Catalyst. You're going to talk about it a million times. You should be good at talking about that. Get good at that, right? You're going to do an elevator speech about what your why is and why you sell real estate and what people get from real estate. And you're going to get good at that because you're going to do that same presentation 100,000 times in your life. And if you're a young person in business, or you just started a new business, figure out how to talk about that because you're gonna say it a million times. Okay, one quick story. 1854, we're gonna go back to 1854. There is a teacher in a one-room schoolhouse, Reverend G.B. Engle, and he has a student, Thomas Alva Edison, 7-year-old Thomas, and he gives him a note, and he says, make sure that you give this to your mother and nobody else. Thomas Alva Edison goes home to to his little home there in Port Huron, Michigan. He gives his mom the note. His mom reads it and breaks down crying. He says, "Mom, why are you crying? What does the note say?" And she said, "This is a note from your teacher at your school. And the note says, Thomas is a genius. He's smarter than anybody at the school. We've taught him everything we know. There's nothing else we have left to teach him. We would suggest that you teach him at home because there's nothing else we can do for him." And they did. So Sarah Edison taught the little Thomas Alva Edison at home, which is probably not even true because he kind of learned on his own. He read every book he can get his hands on. He took everything apart. He put everything back together. And he bugged people, all these adults, "Tell me more, tell me more, tell me more." And of course, Thomas Edison ended up being the most prolific inventor in the history of the world. He's also a prolific marketer. A lot of the things like the light bulb started somewhere else. But Thomas learned to bring it in and learned how to market it and how to sell it, how to tell people about it. He learned how to be a great inventor and a great presenter. And because of that, many of the things that we take for granted right now wouldn't even be here if his mother hadn't done that, taking him home and taught him that. The part of the story a lot of people don't hear is after his mother died, he was going through his mother's things and he found that note. And when he flipped it over and he read it, she had lied to him. It didn't say that Thomas was a genius. It said Thomas is addled. He's an imbecile. We don't want him in the school because he's too stupid for us to teach him anything. He's a disruption to everybody in his class. And we want you to keep him at home because he's never going to amount to anything. Now, aren't we glad that his mother didn't take that at face value? I think you have great ideas that can change your industry, that can change your business, that can change the company, that can change the entire city. And today we spent some time learning how to get those out of you and out onto the stage. And I wish you the best of luck in your endeavors. Thank you. Boom! Drop the mic.
Thank you, Daniel. What a wonderful presentation today. I hope everybody learned something else from you guys for your evaluation. And we are going to give you some wonderful credentials all in one. So it was worth coming today for a number of reasons. But we really appreciate you. We appreciate your time. The energy that you put in today was great to see. The fact that you were willing to get out of your comfort zone, speak to one another, practice something. That was great. I want to ask you to give yourselves a huge round of applause.
There were so many valuable tools and lessons I learned today. But just one, it would be the power that you have as being the speaker. Did not realize that level of power that what you can demand and speaking with, setting up before you are set out to speak. It really shed some light on that you are more in control than previously I realized.
And so what's the first strategy that you're going to implement the next time you have a public speaking?
I would say my introduction. I did not realize, again, setting up a great intro really sets the path for a successful speech. So knowing that knowledge of being able to write my own introduction and being introduced, I definitely will use that going forward.
And so, do you find value in Senior Community Institute's professional development workshops? And if so, why?
Absolutely, there is tremendous value. One, with these talks that are put on, but also with connecting with various community leaders. So I sat at a diverse table today with business leaders from IT to even fast food and retired teachers, and it was interesting perspective to sit down with such a diverse group, and I learned something from each of the participants today.
Perfect. And can you give me your favorite power question?
Absolutely.
Okay. What is one thing you learned today that surprised you about public speaking?
I kind of have the same answer as the last person, that I tell stories. I think one of the things that I learned is that it's better to have them in the present tense and bring them to the present. And the other thing is I liked it that he started off with he was a shy person. I'm a shy person. This is way out of my comfort zone, and I'm trying to break out of it.
What's the first strategy you're going to implement to break out of your comfort zone?
Practice. Actually do some more presentations. But the other thing is to learn to pause. When you don't have the self-confidence, I think sometimes a pause is scary.
Absolutely. And so would you recommend to your community institute training to your friends and colleagues?
Absolutely. This is the third student institute thing that I've been to. I've enjoyed them all, I've implemented them, and I'm looking forward to implementing this one.
And I have to ask you, what is your favorite power pose that you will use for your next one?
Of course, Superwoman.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.